Please join me in welcoming Marco Vangelisti.
Well, thank you, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Thank you, everybody, for coming this beautiful afternoon and spending, you know, 2 hours, albeit in a very nice building, talking about money and banking. We have quite an agenda. First of all, I want to show you what is possible once the money system is fixed, because we have many things that we need to do. And currently, you might want to turn down the volume a little bit. So we'll start with what's possible and what is my motivation for having spent the last 3 years studying and sharing what I learned with regular folks, not academia and not experts. Then we'll look at why money is hard to understand. And then we'll understand money and credit creation. We'll figure out what banks are for. What is the potential positive role of banks, and why the way they are set up right now is not very helpful to society as a whole. And so we'll look at the role of the Federal Reserve and the system design and key questions of the money system. And finally, we'll look at the systemic solutions and possibility and what you can do, the person sitting in your chair. I'm getting a little bit of reverb. I don't know if we can turn down a little bit the volume. But anyhow, the key points of my talk are this, that even though the money system is very complex, banking, especially now with the financialization and globalization of the wholesale market and shadow banking and so on, it's very, very confusing. The key design features of the money system is not that difficult to understand, and everybody can grasp it. So that's what we're going to do. The second one is that a widespread understanding of how the money and banking system works is necessary for democracy. About 100 years ago, besides slavery, the money and banking system was the most hotly debated issue in the country. And everybody, including farmers in Kansas, knew about the problem of money creation, bimetallism, whether silver is used as money or not. I mean, there was a big debate about that. And so we need to build up our understanding so that we can be active participants in our democracy. And the other key point is the money system is really a private-public partnership, where over time the risks have shifted to the public sector and the rewards have shifted to the private sector. And that's something we need to understand. And finally, the fact that we have a private banking system driven by profit leads to the misuse of the awesome privilege that the banking system has, which is money creation. And we'll talk about that. It's kind of surprising to many. And finally, I would argue that the way that money banking is designed right now is involved in most of the difficult and I would say almost intractable problems we're facing now, which means that fixing it would allow us to address some of the largest societal problems we have. So some of you were at my talk a couple of years ago. Can I see a show of hand who actually, okay, not the majority. But this was has changed in my thinking in the last 2 years. At that point, I had recommended that money creation was to be taken away completely from the private banking sector. I kind of softened my view right now and see that credit creation by banks is actually essential in a modern economy and helps with the elasticity of the money supply. It's still a very awesome power that needs to be strictly regulated, but there is a function for banking creating credit within the economy. The second one is that there is a potential positive societal function of banking, which we will talk about, and has to do with, although this will become clearer later, maturity, credit, and liquidity transformation. That is the key function of the banking sector. And these terms might not make sense right now. They will in about 20 minutes. And finally, that the money system is really hierarchical and a hybrid system. And finally, I said finally already, so there are more points coming up here. I don't know who put them there. But anyhow, the Federal Reserve is a key player and the ultimate liquidity provider of liquidity within the system. But my recommendation would remain the same, which is we need to nationalize it. And finally, that US Congress is even more clueless than I thought on this topic. It's amazing how little they know about it. So, what can we do once we fix the money system? This is basically the little carrot that should get you to pay attention for the next, 40 minutes. We have a lot of stuff to do. We have to rebuild our infrastructure. 70,000 bridges have been deemed structurally inadequate. It's a very big investment we need to make. We have to improve the education system. We have to improve the healthcare and prevention. We have to address the issue of climate adaptation. We have to do environmental restoration. We have to rebuild the local food system and infrastructure. We have to repopulate rural areas and transition to organic agriculture. A lot of these things cannot be funded simply by the private sector seeking financial returns. It has to be a common investment. And that common investment cannot drain resources of the Federal Reserve. Of the government itself. So fixing the money system allows the government to finance all this without increasing taxes and without getting farther in debt. So that's a little carrot for you. My motivation for doing this is that after studying this issue, I believe that the money and banking system is basically like running the society on a faulty operating system. Some of you are programmers. I did that in my youth. And if you're trying to write a program that runs on a faulty operating system, it's going to be very, very frustrating. And a lot of the things we're trying to do to better society, to address environmental issues, and so on, are frustrated by the very design of the money and banking system. In fact, I believe the design of the money system is implicated with increasing level of debt, private and public, economic instability, concentration of wealth, loss of democracy, and environmental and climate disruption. And I will try to make the point that the way the system is designed, and once you understand it, you see what the problems are linked to these issues. So let's first start by talking about why is it hard to understand money? I mean, you can go on the web and find all sorts of talks about money, and it's very confusing. The problem is we have four patterns of thought that prevent us from understanding how the money system works. And the first pattern we need to overcome is that there is no free lunch. Well, actually, it's interesting because there is a free lunch in that a lot of the money we use is created through accounting entries. So it seems a little bit hard to believe that we can just create money that way, but we can. The other thought is money is a positive number. You can say money is, I have $100 or $200 in the bank, so when you have money, you have a positive number. Well, it turns out that money is either a positive or a negative number depending on whose balance sheet it sits on. Money is really a creature of accounting. And you need to understand a little bit about balance sheets to understand money. So we'll do balance sheets at 1 p.m. on Sunday in a church. How about that? So the other thought that we need to, pattern of thought that we need to overcome is that money is a creature of the nation state. A lot of people would say, who creates money? Of course, the government, maybe through the Federal Reserve. It's the government that creates money. Well, it turns out that that's not true, or not exclusively true, or mostly not true. And finally, the other thing is that money is uniform. A dollar in your pocket, a dollar in your bank, they're the same type of money. Well, it turns out that money is hierarchical, and even the various players within the money system are in a particular hierarchy. So we'll talk about that in the next 5 minutes. So in order to understand the money system, I have to take you back a little bit because I have to avoid talking about the financialization on the money and banking system. Now finance and banking have been merged. You know, we have the problem of the globalization of the wholesale money market with euro dollars being traded all over the world. And we have the problem of shadow banking. These are the evolution in the money system in the last 30 years. But to understand how the money system works, I'm going to bring you back to like 70 years ago when we had a dollar standard, or 100 years ago. Okay, that would be clearer the 4 points that I made. And the reason is that the systemic design features and consequences would be more easily discernible then. For the experts among you that might think my presentation today is oversimplified, I would recommend either The New Lombard Street by Professor Perry Merling, How the Fed Became the Dealer of Last Resort. It's not an easy book to read, but if you have a good background in monetary theory, it's fantastic to understand what happened in the last 30 years. Or you can go online and listen to Lord Adair Turner, The Micro and Macro, The Risk Managing in an Unstable System. By the way, if I have here a mailing list, if you want to add yourself to the mailing list, I will send you a link to this talk. It's really amazing, but it's a bit technical. For the rest of you, we'll just start very simple. And I'm going to show you here a very simplified balance sheet of three players in the money system: a central bank, private banks, and the private sector. And during the gold standard, central banks were making payments among nations. You know, nations would trade with each other, and then there would be a balance of trade that needs to be, you know, a nation was a nation debtor and had to pay a nation creditor. And that would occur through the shipment of actual physical gold. And the gold was held usually by the central bank. And so gold was an asset of the central bank. And the central bank could actually issue the national currency. So the national currency is actually a liability of the central bank. But it was an asset of the private banks. The private banks were holding the currency issued by the Federal Reserve as one of their assets, and they could issue deposits. The money in the checking account is a liability of the bank, but it is an asset of the private sector. So, and by the way, the private sector could issue IOUs. Let me give you an example. You see a friend, he has a bike, you want the bike, you don't have the money on you, you're gonna write on a little piece of paper, I owe you $100, and you give the little piece of paper to your friend, you get the bike. You effectively created a type of money that facilitated that economic transaction. But it's not quite the ultimate money, because eventually you'll have to give your friend either a check from the bank, which is money that the banks create, a deposit of the bank, or you have to give them $100 in paper, which is the liability of the Federal Reserve, right? And if you go up the chain, you find out that the same thing is true for the banking sector. The banks can create deposits, and I'll show you how they do that, but they cannot use money they create to settle their own accounts. They have to use Federal Reserve deposits. So something that is created higher up in the hierarchy. Similarly, during the gold standard, the Federal Reserve could issue currency. They can create it out of nothing, so to speak, but they couldn't use that to settle the international payment for which gold was required. This picture shows you a couple of things. Money is either positive or negative, depending on where it sits in a balance sheet of whom. Second, it shows you the hierarchical structure of money, where gold, in this case, will be at the top of the hierarchy, the currency created by the Federal Reserve just below it, the money created by the banks in terms of deposits below that, and any money created by the private sector even farther down. And it shows you that the hybrid nature of the system, where part of it is created by, let's say, a central bank, assuming the central bank is a public entity like in England, where the Bank of England has been nationalized in 1947 and is therefore part of the government, and part is private money. So you can see a hierarchy of money right there, and we're going to focus just on these two types of money, national currencies and deposits today. But you need to keep in mind that there is a big difference between a dollar in your pocket and a dollar in the bank, although the whole banking system is set up to maintain par between the two. So you can go to a bank and get your, you know, deposit $100, and you get $100 in your checking account, one-to-one. Or you can go to the ATM and get $100 out, so convert the $100 in your checking account into cash. But that's not always the case. As the people in Cyprus found out in 2013, when they tried to get their deposits out of the bank, and whoops, 50% of that had been used by the banks to recapitalize themselves. Or something like that happened in Argentina and so on. So when you're thinking about the money system, you need to ask a number of questions. And these are the questions you need to ask. First one, who creates money? The second one is, by what authority do they create that money? Who captures the seigniorage? Now, seigniorage is kind of a funny word. It's French, I believe. And how many of you know what seigniorage is? Okay, a couple of experts here in the room. All right, the seigniorage is the difference between the cost of producing fiat money and the face value of fiat money. This little piece of paper costs about 12 cents. If you want to print this, it costs 12 cents to print it. Now, it used to cost 5 cents when it didn't have all the fancy ink and so on, but now it's 12 cents. So the seigniorage is the difference between 12 cents and $100. Wouldn't it be an interesting question to ask, who has the privilege to pay 12 cents for this piece of paper and get $100 for it? Now, if you try to do that in your basement, it's not going to end up very well. But that's the seigniorage. Now, what is money backed by? Right? We don't have a gold standard, so at least these guys no longer are backed by gold. So what are they backed by? And who benefits and who bears the risk of that process of money creation? Who controls the quantity of money in the economy? What incentives drive credit creation and money creation? So those are the key questions, and we will address those, and you will get a sense by the end of how to answer them. And I'm not going to embarrass you by asking you now to answer those questions. So the first thing we're going to do is banking and money creation. And this is, remember what I said, we need to overcome this thought that there is no free lunch. And the other thing that I mentioned is that money is a creature of accounting. So I will show you how, with a little bit of accounting, we can create money. It's really funny. So it turns out we need to know very basic accounting if we want to understand our money supply, the money creation process, and the system of payments. So we'll start very simple. Imagine you and a few friends happen to have $1 million in cash, and you're trying to think about what can we do with it? Interest rates are so low right now, maybe we should start a business. Why don't we start a bank? So you could do that. You can start a bank, although it's kind of hard to start a brand new bank nowadays. But what you can do is you could buy a building for $500,000, and then you put the rest of the money in the vault in the building, and then a nice little sign saying, we have a new bank, we're open for business. The balance sheet of that bank at that point will look like that. On the liability side, you have $1 million in equity capital, which is the capital contributed by your friends. And on the asset side, you have the cash, $500,000 left, and the building. Okay? Fair enough? We're all there? Good. The first customer arrives with $200,000 in cash. Again, an unusual deposit. We're not going to ask a lot of questions about it. But I can tell you that it smells a little bit funny. It has a little aroma around it. But anyhow, we take the money in. We don't ask too many questions. And the person deposits $200,000. What happens to the balance sheet of that bank? So this little change, which is very interesting, the assets of the bank increased by $200,000. And something called a checking account is being created on the other side, which is a liability of the bank. Now, this little accounting transaction is like poetry. It tells a lot of things in a very synthetic way. The first thing that it tells is that the cash that you deposited is no longer yours. The ownership of that cash is transferred to the bank, and the bank can count it as its assets. Now you're saying, wait a second, but the $200,000 in my checking account, isn't that money? Kind of. It's actually not exactly money. It is a promise that the bank has made to you to make payments on your behalf up to $200,000 if everything goes well. You are actually an uncollateralized creditor of the bank. This is an uncollateralized liability of the bank. Now, a little bit more complicated. Somebody comes and borrows $300,000. Okay? Now, a lot of people think that banks are financial intermediaries. They take money from depositors and they lend them out. And if you look at the textbook, they always say they lend them out to entrepreneurs building the next business, right? And there are like intermediaries facilitating excess, the collection of excess savings and give it to the people that are creating the next economy. Well, if that's were the case, then they would just give the cash that they have to the new person. But that is not exactly what happens. Here's what happens. The bank accepts the promise to repay of the borrower and puts it as one of its assets. This could be a mortgage. So that basically you sign the mortgage and the bank says, thank you very much, this will be an asset. We will create for you $300,000 in your checking account. This is electronic money that did not exist before. It is created through an expansion of the balance sheet of the bank, and it's brand new electronic money. Now, of course, people borrow money to spend it, and that's the catch. So the question is, are they going to spend it with someone who is already a member of this bank, or do they spend it with someone who is a member of a different bank? So let's start easy and imagine that the customer B pays customer C that is also a member of the same bank. What happens? Focus your attention on this little letter here, please, the B. This is what happens. That's it. Did you see it? Okay, let me do it again. So it goes from B to C. That's it. All the bank has to do is just change the ledger and say this $300,000 in the checking account are not all longer B's, they are C's. That's it. Now, it's a little bit more complicated if the person that is being paid is not part of the same bank. In that case, you have to involve the Federal Reserve. So let's bring in the Federal Reserve and assume that Bank One deposits some of that cash. By the way, banks have very little cash on hand. And if by any chance you one day walk into a bank and say, I would like to withdraw $30,000 in cash, you know what they're going to tell you? Come back on Thursday. They don't have that much cash on hand. So a lot of banks actually would have federal fund deposits instead of cash in their vault. So let me just first show you the balance sheet of the Federal Reserve. Remember what we said, the cash, the currency issued by the Federal Reserve is a liability of the Federal Reserve. And usually the Federal Reserve has some assets corresponding to it. Historically, those have been US Treasuries and US Treasury bills. Things have changed, though. Anyhow, so what happens when Bank One deposits some cash with the Federal Reserve? Basically, it's a swap of liability. The cash in the Federal Reserve gets reduced by $300,000. The Federal Reserve creates out of nothing electronic checking account in the same way as Bank One did, called federal fund deposits for Bank One, and that becomes an asset of Bank One. So Bank One simply has transformed some of its cash into an electronic money issued by the Federal Reserve and only used by banks. If you are a regular person, you'll never use or touch federal fund deposits. Okay? So now, how does the payment occur to customer C, who's customer of a different bank? So you need to actually keep track of three things that are going to change. One is the checking account of person B will disappear, right? Because he's writing a check, that thing will disappear. What will disappear on the left-hand side of Bank One is a correspondent amount of federal fund deposits. And what you'll see up on the Federal Reserve is that those $300,000 of federal fund deposits will be then credited to Bank Two. That's what happens. You see, there is a little contraction of the balance sheet of Bank One as the checking account of B disappears. The federal fund deposits go to 500 to 200, and the 300 are transferred in the bank of customer C. So what's happening to the balance sheet of Bank Two? You can imagine, it grows, so the assets are $300,000 more of federal fund deposits, and they create a brand new checking account for $300,000 for customer C. That's how payments are done. But remember, the initial loan is what introduced that new electronic money. That gets transferred to a new bank, maybe, but that's basically the process by which money is created. Now, the interesting thing is that 95% of the money we use is electronic money created through the process of bank lending. So the question is, how much money can a bank create by lending? For that, you need to know that we have something called, I'll start simple. Let's imagine we only have one bank. So none of this, monkeying around with Federal Reserves going up and down. Just imagine there's one big bank. Then at that point, what is constraining is the reserve requirement in the United States. The reserve requirements basically say, if you're a bank and you're making demand deposits, you're creating money in that way, you need to have at least 10% of your demand deposits in the form of reserves. And both cash and federal fund deposits count towards your reserves. So this bank has $500,000, actually $700,000 of reserves, and has $500,000 of deposits. It could actually create how much money by lending? Does anybody know? Has anybody followed the math? $7 million, right? It has $700,000. It could have $7 million worth of demand deposits there. So it could technically lend out an additional $6.5 million. So this bank, if it were the one and only, could create $7 million worth of deposits. Now you're saying, well, but we have more than one bank in the United States. That is true, although we're moving towards a single bank. This is basically from 1996 to 2009, the number of banks that have been gobbled up by the top four, Citicorp, JP Morgan, Bank of America, and Wells Fargo. So these large banks are more likely to have their customers make payments to other customers of theirs, for which no transfer of federal fund deposits need to occur. And the other one is we actually have an overnight federal fund market where banks with excess reserves can lend them to banks with deficit reserves. In other words, this trading of reserves overnight makes the whole banking system act as a single bank. And because of that, whatever reserves are in the banking sector, the banking system can have 10 times as much of money creation in the economy. So the question is, what do we have? Well, this is actually the aggregate balance sheet And I know this is like 12:45 in the afternoon after lunch, so looking at balance sheets is tough. But this is the aggregate balance sheet of commercial banks in the United States as of about a month ago, last time I checked it. And so what they have here is about $9 trillion worth of demand deposits. These numbers are in billions of dollars. These are large numbers, by the way. Time deposits are basically almost similar, same money created but locked in for like either a month or 2 months. And then they borrowed some other funds, and this is the equity capital. Remember, that was the initial equity capital of the bank and so on. On the asset side, what you see is a lot of lending in securities, commercial loans, real estate loans, consumer loans, other assets, and treasury bonds, mortgage-backed securities, and CDOs, and so on. So one way to think about this is that the private banking sector has created effectively, over time, more than $10 trillion worth of money, and has done that in the process of lending it out. So this is a little bit tricky because, you see, what happens is that since the banking sector can create money when it lends it out, it can decide the first use of that money, and it can decide the quantity at the end of the day. If you see the cash in Federal Reserves, this is something that happened after the financial crisis. Before the financial crisis, there were $50 billion worth of federal fund deposits in the whole United States. That was the entire amount of reserves in the system. Now there are 3,100 billion. These are the reserves of the banking sector, which are humongous. It's more than we need, right? And in fact, if the bank ever decided to lend like crazy, they would not be constrained by the reserve requirements until they created $30 trillion worth of additional credit. The problem is that they're not lending very much. And that's basically the pushing on the string that John Maynard Keynes was talking about, where the Federal Reserve is trying to flood the system with reserves, make it really easy to borrow because the interest rates are so low. But if people are not willing to borrow because, for example, they borrow to the hilt, that does not get more money circulating into the economy. But the way you can think about it is that there are a couple of ways. One is the banking sector created this money to buy for itself those interesting assets that either are collateralized, which means you don't repay your mortgage, we can get your actual house, or that pay interest on it. And in fact, what happened during the run-up to the financial crisis of 2007 is that banks created way too much money to get real estate loans going. They were lending to everybody and their dog to buy homes. And they didn't quite care about that because A, they could get the home if you didn't pay, but most importantly, they could sell those mortgages to Wall Street, and Wall Street packaged them in mortgage-backed securities and collateralized debt obligation, then they were sold around the world. So they didn't even hold that risk on their books. So what are banks good for? In my very first talk 2 years ago, I said we simply need to take away the money, the power to create money by the banks. In other words, 100% reserve requirement for banks. And then the Federal Reserve and the central government would be in a position to determine how much money to put into the economy. Because you see, there is a motivation for the banks to lend as much as possible during good times, right? And so create excessive amount of money that creates bubbles, like real estate bubbles, or like bubbles in the financial sector. And we'll talk about that in the next couple of minutes. But banks are actually good for something. What are they good for? Well, the bank credit, or money that they create, right, when they extend loans, it's also called credit, creates elasticity in the money supply. And so the idea is that if certain economic activities need to happen, you know, a local bank can allow that to happen through credit creation. The other one is they're doing an underwriting service. Effectively, banking is all about swapping of IOUs. you come in and say, I need a mortgage. And so you are saying to the bank, I owe you the money of the mortgage. And the bank says, no, I owe you money. In fact, this checking account is my liability to you. Right? So it's really a swap of IOU. So in other words, the banks monetize people's and economic agents' promises to repay. And so the question is, whose liability do you monetize is the function of the bank. The bank are in a position to say, okay, you get to monetize your liability and you don't, right? So there is that underwriting function. And you know, you could postpone the realization of failure, hoping maybe for a turnaround. A business not doing very well, say, you know, but with another $1 million, I can get over the hump, possibly. Or they can anticipate the realization of success. I'm a startup, I have this really hot idea, I just need $100 million, you know, whatever, $1 million to make it happen. And then you will bask in the success of, you know, my success and your success and so on. But at the end of the day, the function, the key function of the banking sector is maturity, liquidity, and credit transformation. So let me explain that. First of all, maturity. If you get a mortgage that is a 30-year mortgage, the maturity of that is 30 years. In other words, it will take you 30 years to repay your thing. Money, on the other hand, has immediate maturity. You don't have to wait until tomorrow to spend it. You can spend it today. So if a bank takes your mortgage and turns it into money, it has done a maturity transformation from 30 years to now. That's maturity transformation. How about liquidity? Liquidity is whether you can buy or sell certain things. You can have a 30-year treasury bond, and yes, the maturity is 30 years, but you can sell it, no problem. So it's very liquid. Your mortgage is not very liquid. You know, who do you sell it to? Now, banks actually started selling to Wall Street, but that's exactly the point. They render your illiquid mortgage into something that can be bought and sold. So they do liquidity transformation. They also do credit transformation. Now, your credit might be 730 FICO or whatever, and you still qualify for a mortgage, but a bank has a better credit than you because it has a capital buffer and then has the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation that says if the bank cannot make it, the government will step in. And so, as you can see, if you look at this, the bank has done maturity, credit, and liquidity transformation with the things that it has on its assets and turned them into liabilities that can be used as money today by everybody. And by the way, I'm a big fan of local currencies, but local currencies do not have the ability to transform liquidity, maturity, and credit. And that is the power of the banking system as set up now, which we should retain, but just be mindful of how destructive it can be if this power and privilege is used just for profit maximization issues, goals. All right, so we've seen what the banks are good for. What is the awesome power of banks? Can basically, again, give you a free pass. You're in a crunch, you are going to go bust. Well, you can go to the bank and they can breathe a little bit more life into your business. Banks' liabilities are our money. In other words, they create the money we use. It's a tremendous power. And the banks support and encourage what they monetize. That's why they supported the real estate market by monetizing a lot of the promises to buy those houses. We didn't build all new houses. We just chased the same set of houses with more and more money going after it, with larger and larger mortgages. That's why it's so hard for young people to afford to buy a home, and why in the 50s the median home was about 1 year worth of salary, median salary, and now is 6-7 times that much. This unaffordability in houses is linked to the money creation of the banks and the fact that they love to lend into secure assets like homes. and credit allocation. They decide who gets cash. You know, do we monetize the people that are trying to buy homes, or do we monetize businesses? And for that, this is an interesting study done by the Positive Money Institute, which is a group in England that has been studying these issues. And actually, it was funny because I found them a couple of years after they started, and then we compared notes and say, you know, oh, guys, you came to the same conclusion. So they actually have a lot of good videos and introductory videos on this. What they found is that from 1997 to 2007, in the 10 years leading up to the financial crisis, they looked at the money creation by banks in the UK, and they found that 40% of the money they created went into housing. The housing market went up 300% over that period of time, thank you very much. 37% into financial speculation, and that's something that it's really big. A lot of the money created by the banks is given to financial institutions to do carry trades and buy other securities or other things around the world. And I can give you an example of that. Only 13% of the money creation goes to what the textbooks say the banks are funding, which is non-financial businesses that creates the goods and services we all need. And if you think about that, if you create new money and it goes into the hands of people that create goods and services, the new goods and services absorb that additional money so that it's not necessarily inflationary. But if that money gets created to buy the same set of houses or the same set of stocks in the stock market, what you're doing is you're inflating those prices. So, Federal Reserve, friend or foe? Now, the Federal Reserve is funny because everybody has very strong opinions about the Federal Reserve. And the interesting thing to understand is that it is a hybrid institution. It's part banker's bank and is part government bank. But it's mostly banker's bank. And it tends to... So therefore can be the bogeyman for both anti-government and pro-government groups, right? There are some people say, abolish Federal Reserve because it's big government. And other people say, abolish Federal Reserve because it's private. Well, it turns out that we can't abolish it because it's key to the functioning of the modern economy, but we should really take a close look at what are the incentives, who owns it, and how it operates. So, there is this, if you look at the textbook, they say, we have a private Federal Reserve because that guarantees the independence from political pressure. So that the politicians cannot say to the Federal Reserve, lower interest rates so that the economy is going to grow and I'm going to get reelected. But really the problem is, if you think about that, is that the Federal Reserve is probably the poster boy for unconstitutional private delegation. There is something in our system of law that says Congress should not delegate rulemaking or law making to private entities. And that's effectively what we have done. We have given to a private cartel of banks rulemaking authority over the amount of money, open market operations, and interest rates, monetary policy, things that really should be a government function. So that's a big one. A number of challenges have tried to get to the Supreme Court. They never haven't made it there yet because have been dismissed on grounds of lack of standing and other technical reasons. But if you really look at it, the way it is set up right now, it is unconstitutional. And so the problem is that right now the allegiance of the Federal Reserve is primarily with the banks and their financial interest. That's why Tim Geithner has not reined in the crazy lending of the banks up to 2007, even though the Federal Reserve has regulatory power over the banks, or should have, because that would have basically reduced the profitability of banks. And so, you had no income. First you have, you can borrow up to 100% of the value of the house, and then up to 105%, and then you have no income, no worries, you have no income. Well, still, I can lend you money. No income, no job, no assets, the ninja loans. I mean, the Federal Reserve at that point, if it had been, you know, in operating in the interest of the economy as a whole or of all of us, would have basically tightened the screw really hard on those lending practices of the banks, but did not. And so Tim Geithner was rewarded by being appointed Treasury Secretary. So, allegiance usually shifts towards its public mandate only during crisis. And even in this crisis, actually, what happened is that the Federal Reserve has stepped in to support a private market in mortgage-backed securities, which is really unheard of so far in the 100 years history of the Federal Reserve. So what are the functions of the Federal Reserve? Is the issuer of the national currency, sits at the top of the money hierarchy, and is the ultimate provider of liquidity to the banking system. Now, if you think about the banking system, what I mentioned is does maturity transformation, right? So it has $9 trillion worth of demand deposit that people could simply say, I want my money now. What is it backing that? All those assets that are not as liquid. And so what happens is that if a lot of people say, I want my cash now, after they run out of their reserves, they would have to liquidate some of those assets. And so the Federal Reserve is there to provide liquidity to the banking sector that is itself providing the maturity transformation in the economy. So it's a lender or dealer of last resort and, you know, supposedly manages the money supply, but I would argue it has not done its job in the run-up to the financial crisis. It has not reined in the money creation of the private banking sector when they were lending to everybody and their dog to buy homes. So there's the balance sheet of the Federal Reserve. The federal fund deposits used to be before the crisis, you see now $2,550 billion. That number used to be $50 billion. And in fact, the whole balance sheet of the Federal Reserve used to be about $700 billion instead of $4,500 billions. So the Federal Reserve has expanded its balance sheet. And remember, every time the Federal Reserve buys something, it just creates the money to do so. It's really amazing. Wouldn't you love to have that business? And, you know, so it has been buying up, and this is the first time in its history, really, mortgage-backed securities. It has done that to support the market for private securities that needed a lot of support because a lot of them were created by all those crazy mortgages that were originated in the years prior to the financial crisis. And that is part of the reason why the home prices still are so high and growing. There's been a tremendous amount of support for those prices by the Federal Reserve being the ultimate buyer of those securities, which is the packaged result of all those mortgages. I'm not going to go into this, but this is the history of the balance sheet of the Federal Reserve after the crisis, the assets and the liabilities is, but one thing that I want to, you get a sense that something really radical has happened, because if you look before 2008, like 30 years, that's pretty much how the balance sheet has been looking. A lot of blue, meaning a lot of, let's see, these are the liabilities. So those are where basically the currency in circulation. So it's basically just the dollars in circulation and very little reserve, tiny, tiny brown sliver at the bottom you cannot even see. That's all that was needed for the banking sector. And in terms of assets, was all government bonds and treasury bills, actually going back to the Second World War. And then all of a sudden, boom, things change, balance sheet expands, a lot of money creation to kind of keep the whole thing going, but we haven't fixed really the key issue. So I don't wanna spend too much time there because I want to go into the what are the systemic issues and the solutions, and then we'll open it up for questions for all of you. So who creates money? Mostly the private banking sector, when they make loans. In fact, I have a slide on that with the actual amount. By what authority? Now, the Federal Reserve creates the paper money. The authority was granted in 1913 with the Federal Reserve Act. The Treasury issues the metal coins. So that's the only debt-free government money that has been created right now. Tiny, tiny little things. You know, by what authority the banking system is creating all this money? You know, I don't think we actually had a discussion as a society. You know, is this a power, money creation, that needs to be in the hands of a private, for-profit entity? I mean, it seems almost like puzzling when you think about it. Who captured the seigniorage? Now, what is the seigniorage of electronic money created by the banks? How much does it cost to type 100,000 or 500,000 into a computer and to create a checking account with that amount? Nothing. So all of that is seigniorage that is being captured by the private banking sector. Even more, you know, they do even a better job than the Federal Reserve, which pays 12 cents for this and gets $100. So what is the money backed by? In terms of the Federal Reserve, usually Treasury bonds and other assets. In terms of the banks, by the assets that they have. So that's the problem we had during the financial crisis, when a lot of the assets of the banks were mortgages of poor quality. And then all of a sudden, our entire system of money and payments was being threatened by the poor quality of the assets of the banks. And what did the government had to do? Create a TARP, Troubled Asset Relief Program, borrow $700 billion, because the government has to borrow money, to bail out the banks and clean up their books, to preserve the integrity of the payment system. So what are the design problems of the system as we have it? What's wrong with the system? First of all money is created as debt. The banks decide the first use of that money and decide the quantity of that money based on their own individual assessment of the health of the economy and their profit motive. So they tend to create too much in the good times and not enough in the bad times. But this is the biggest problem that a lot of people have not really thought about. When you borrow $500,000 for your mortgage, $500,000 in electronic money enters the system. You, on the other hand, have to return to the bank more than $500,000. By the time you factor in all the interest over 30 years, it might be $1 million. So no one within the system creates the money to repay the interest associated with the loans that generate the money in the first place. This creates the scarcity of money within the system. It is mathematical that somebody will default on their debt obligations, because there isn't enough money in circulation to pay all the debts that are created when money is issued. That is really a fundamental problem of the money system. And you can see now, even at the national level, when kind of governments step in and take on the debt, Greece, Puerto Rico, and so on, eventually they also crash, because there is more debt out there than money to pay for it. This also drives us to continuous growth. Because if you can pretend that the economy is bigger next year than this year, you can borrow more, and you need to do so to repay the principal and the interest for which no money was ever created. This also drives environmental destruction, if you think about that. If you're a farmer, you can meet your quota, your debt, you maybe cut the forest if you have a forest, and trying to monetize that. So a lot of the environmental destruction, the drive towards economic growth, is driven by this very little flaw in the design system of our money system. The private banking sector has effectively the monopoly on money creation. It is really a government function, and it's now completely in the hands of the private sector. 97-98% of the money is created that way. Now, what is the problem? The government, when it doesn't have enough taxes to pay for the services, it has to borrow. Who does it borrow money from? Primarily the private banking sector that can create the electronic money to buy those securities, or the people that have a lot of money already. And if you think about that, if all our money is created as debt, we are paying interest on our money supply every year. That is a tax on the productive economy that takes money from the general public and gives it to either the people that can create the money, the banking sector, or the people that already have a lot of money and can lend it. That is what makes the increase in wealth, inequality in this country, a mathematical certainty. And that's, you know, a lot of people talk about inequality and how it's growing. This is one of the primary mechanisms by which inequality is growing. 90-95% of the population is paying interest, 5%, 10% of the population receives interest. And those are the people that already have assets or the people that can create it through the banking sector. The profit motive leads to inappropriate money creation and allocation. Small businesses are in dire need of credit right now. But banks only overall have, you know, lent at least lately 10-15% of all their money creation in the directed into productive economic activity. A lot of it goes into financial speculation or real estate. So the credit allocation and the amount of money that is being created is not managed for the interest of the population as a whole. Let me give you a radical example of money created for the financial speculation. There is a company called Oryx in Japan. It's a large financial company that does mostly real estate development. They sold their stock on the stock market and raised $20 billion in equity capital. And then they went to one of the Japanese banks and say, could you lend us an additional $80 billion? Japanese bank said, sure, no problem. They just created out of nothing $80 billion. By the way, the interest in the basis points, you know, the interest rates in Japan are super, super low, maybe 0.1, 0.2%. You would say, well, that's pitiful. But if you multiply that by $80 billion, it's between $80 and $160 million a year in interest for the privilege of creating this electronic money. And now we have $80 billion more slashing around the world trying to buy either real estate or other investments. A lot of the money created by the banking sector is giving, is created for the purpose of financial speculation. That's also in part why the stock market has been doing so well and then crashed, and you know, who knows what it's really worth. And the debt-based money system is, in my view, in the process of collapsing. You can see it, many, many symptoms of that. Now, the federal government in the United States is in the super privileged position that its money, the dollars, is the ultimate currency for the settlement of international payments. So the US government right now is the only government that doesn't actually have to worry that much, although there are other issues for not, you know, piling on more debt. But like all the debt debacle, like the debt ceiling and all that stuff is all garbage. You know, you really don't have to worry about that in terms of the government ever running out of money or ever not being able to repay its debt, because it can always, you know, there has no discipline imposed by any foreign entities, because the dollar is the money that is used for international settlements. Now, all the other nations actually do have to pay attention to that. Greece and Puerto Rico and Italy and Spain and so on. Anyhow, very briefly, because we need to wrap this one up and then go to the solution. Who creates money? US Treasury issues metal coins. The Federal Reserve issues paper currency, and the reserves used by the electronic money used by banks for their interbank payments. The banks issue bank deposits when they make loans. That's who creates money in our country. How much? Tiny, tiny little bit, US Treasury, 40 billions in coins. It's actually debt-free money, so it's not a liability of the Federal Reserve, of the government. The Federal Reserve, about, you saw the balance sheet, $4,000 billions or $4 trillion, $2.5 trillion in reserves right now, and $1.5 trillion in paper currency. By the way, the majority of the paper currency in the United States is not in the United States. A lot of people are using this guy's all over the world doing who knows what. Banks right now, we looked at the books as of a month ago, they create about $11 trillion worth of money. So that's basically where we are. There's another chart by the Positive Money Institute. You know, you can see the cash created by the Bank of England, tiny bit, bank-issued money, the one that they issued by creating, lending, and then the debt. And you can see that the debt is greater than the total amount of money in circulation. And what we really need is this. We need a situation where the debt starts coming down and the money grows so that we can actually meet the debt obligation and then, you know, not be completely choked by it. So how do we get there? How would a solution look like? Basically, what we need is partial debt-free money creation by the US Treasury to finance high-priority social programs like education, healthcare, basic income, whatever. We need the government to issue enough debt-free money to at least cover the legacy interest for which there is no money to repay. Okay, so this can take the form of a basic income for everybody in the country, or could be, you know, whatever social priorities we have. But this is money that would not increase the debt of the government. It will be debt-free money, similar to the, we've done that in the past with the greenbacks and so on. We actually done it in California with the IOUs during about 10 years ago. Anyhow, interesting stuff. Or whatever priorities. I mean, we need to figure out what are the priorities of the country and what we can finance with this money that is not does not need to come in from taxes and does not need to be borrowed. The balance sheet of the Fed really needs to be considered something that should be a common. If the Federal Reserve can just create money and they can take on their assets whatever they want, you know, maybe that's a way to finance environmental restoration. And that would basically just sit on the books of the banks, and the Federal Reserve would create the money to do the environmental restoration we need. Cannot be done with a for-profit model. The balance sheet could help finance the U.S. Reconstruction Finance Corporation. We actually had something like that. Basically a public bank that was financing the reconstruction of the country, you know, the bridges, the dams, the post offices, and so on. We can do the same. And the Federal Reserve could buy the bonds issued by this Reconstruction Corporation, and we could rebuild this country that way. And finally, we need to direct the credit creation of the banks in the sectors that are beneficial to society. So if we leave the private banking sector with the power to create money, then there needs to be quite strict guidance as to where the credit is created so that it goes into the real economy and not for financial speculation and for the enrichment of the few. So basically, this is what it's happening now. The US Treasury is part of the public. The Federal Reserve is really a private entity with kind of a quasi-public functions. And then the banking sector is completely private right now. We need to move towards the solution, which means we need to nationalize the Federal Reserve and do what England did in 1947, and have that being an accountable federal agency that operates in the interest of the collectivity and not just of the largest banks. And the banking sector needs to be a mixture of private and public. So I am a strong supporter of public banks as a complement to the private banks. So right now, this is the situation. We have the too big to fail private banks, and we have very few, you know, relatively speaking, smaller banks, and they're being gobbled up. You saw the chart. We need to get to this place where there are no too big to fail private banks, and where there are some public banks also that are competing in the mix and trying to address the issue. This can be done, by the way, in a fairly smooth way by having increasing federal deposit insurance premiums for larger and larger entities. If the larger entities have and present a systemic risk, they need to pay more for that insurance. They could also have increased capital requirements and reserve requirements for the larger entities. And this would basically provide an incentive for those large entities to reduce themselves, break them up a little bit, and have no more too big to fail banks that the government then is on the hook to correct. So, and I would say I'll skip that maybe, which is the history of how that was done in the colony. This is the solution also in terms of debt versus debt-free money issuance. Right now, only 40 billion of the money we use is debt-free, which is the coins. Most of it is debt-based. We need to have a substantial issuance of debt-free money by the U.S. Treasury. We need probably to increase the role of the Federal Reserve once it's part of the government, and we need to reduce the power of the banking sector and its money creation ability. So that's what we can do. U.S. Treasury can fund basic social needs. Federal Reserve could fund the natural commons, the infrastructure projects, and supporting small and medium enterprises lending. And banks, you know, could fund productive economic activity, not financial or real estate bubbles. So with that, we can really address the big issues we have in this country, reduce the power of private banks and money on government, remove artificial scarcity in the money supply. And, you know, I like the idea of if we are a compassionate society, why should we have 50 million people being food insecure and having millions of people living on the street and millions of people on this country living on less than $2 a day, which is the extreme poverty worldwide, right? We should have a national dividend, say everybody gets $1,000, whatever it is. You know, everybody should have the minimum covered, you know, so that we don't have people on the street, people starving, and so on. So that's something that we can definitely talk about. And we need to reduce government and private debt, which is way too much. So that's what we can do once we fix the system. I would say, what can you do? Learn about money and banking. You know, 100 years ago, people, regular people, knew about the issues of banking, of money creation, of minting of gold and silver, the big fight over the, 1873 when bimetallism was stopped. Even the Wizard of Oz is considered, you know, a parody, an allegory of the monetary debate at the time. We need to overcome our shyness about understanding the money and banking system because it really affects our life in a very deep way. And we need to be able to say to our representatives, you know, we want these things. You know, it's not acceptable for the government to bail out the banks and then give them right back to the same management, you know, to pay incredible bonuses. That in 2007, if we have enough understanding, we would have nationalized the largest banks, which is, you know, the funny thing. Here's the funny thing. The U.S. Treasury injected liquidity into Citibank by buying $25 billion worth of preferred equity shares in Citigroup. Okay, $25 billion to get a minority non-voting stake of the company. That day, the whole Citigroup was worth $23 billion on the stock market. You could have bought the whole thing for less and just nationalized it, and maybe broken down in pieces, or doing what, for example, the Swedish government did when they had their financial crisis, but, you know, nationalize the big banks, clean them up, fire the board and the management, chop them in pieces, and at that point, maybe sell them back into the private sector if need be. But we didn't do that because not enough people understood, and Congress was clueless about the topic. So I'm starting from the bottom so that everybody understands this basic issues, and so that's one thing. Spread the word. I hope now we have a TV program there. You can point them to, you can sign my newsletter. I will send you a link to the talk that I mentioned at the beginning if you want, but spread the word. Move your money. The banks that are too big to fail can be resized by us. Just move the money away from the very big, large banks that are a systemic risk because of their size, and move them to local, regional banks and credit unions. Local and regional banks and credit unions are doing most of the local lending in this country, even though they only have 21% of the assets of this country. So if you want to support your local economy, move your money from the large banks to the small regional banks and credit unions that are already doing what we would like the system to look like. Okay? The other one is lobby for a public bank in your state or county. There is a public banking movement in the United States that needs to be supported. Support the use of local currencies and lets. You know, having local currencies is very important. In the scarcity of the money supply, due to the fact that there is more debt than money, having other ways of mobilizing economic activity that does not use the dollars is a good thing. There are local currencies here. There is the Bay Bucks. There is other currencies that you can look into. And finally, support candidates who understand the issue. Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren are two senators that actually understand the system and how we need to retake the power to create money and allocate credit for the use of, for the benefit of the community as a whole. Questions, comments? Would you like to come up to?
I have to turn this on.
Okay.
And ask everyone please to line up behind.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'll ask everyone to please line up behind this mic with your questions. Please phrase them in the form of a question as opposed to, say, a speech. And we'll get going. And please remember that sessions 2 and 3 will be even more revelation than this one. Mark your calendars, Sunday, October 8th, Sunday, October 25th, and you can register at the link shown on the right. Did I not say October 18th? I'm sorry, the 18th. Yes, that's right. I give the floor to my esteemed fool and fellow colleague, Eugene Fears.
So I fully agree we need to nationalize the Fed. But my Andrew Jackson did that. President Jackson did that, and the United States experienced enormous growth because of the lack of debt. But the problem is, key custodians, who supervises the supervisors? Because once it's a function of the federal government, how do we make sure we don't end up with something similar where the money creation becomes a political tool?
Right, and this is, to a certain extent, the big challenges we have is even maybe more profound than this. We have a very corrupt political system, and that is the reality. And that's something that we need to change in this country. And eventually people will have to engage with that, because obviously if you have a government that is captured by private interest in the pockets of the rich people, it doesn't matter. I mean, you put the Federal Reserve under the government and then, you know, it still does the same thing. So those are like two separate issues, but the issue of the corruption, which is actually all legal, that's a funny thing. You know, it's like billionaires can spend billions of dollars selecting the next president or, you know, supporting various. I mean, that is a problem in our country. But we have to think about what would the world look like when it's going to be sane again. And the reason why is because we will have a chance to intervene during crisis. Like the 2007 was a wasted crisis for democracy, because that was an opening for reining in you know, the power of the large banks, the influence of Wall Street on government and so on. So it's, you know, it's part is the cultural work of understanding and creating the movement. And I recognize that the government right now is very corrupt, but it's not completely lost. We still have people that are fighting the good fight. You know, Elizabeth Warren, and we have Bernie Sanders. We have some amazing people that are still hanging on, and they need our support to shift things in a positive way. Yes.
Hi, I have two questions. One is, how do you see Bitcoin fitting into all this, and what are some of your views on that? And then my second question is about the more recent volatility, and do you see that that's going to get worse, calm down? Is some people talk about catastrophic things.
Right. So yes, those are two good questions. Now, Bitcoin is an alternative to the current money system. I have some concern about Bitcoin, but in general, let's say that we need to move to a larger diversity of currencies. You know that the research that has been done on system theory and resilience found out that in order for a system to be resilient, it has to have the right balance between diversity and efficiency. It's super efficient to have just one currency. It's not resilient. So as soon as there is a shock, you could have the whole system come down, as we saw in 2007. So we need to move to a situation where there is a diversity of currencies. And Bitcoin is providing diversity. It has some other issues that I don't want to get into. But I would say, overall, is a step in the right direction to have alternatives and monetary diversity. Now, in terms of the volatility, and that's part of the argument that I will make on October 25th, about the financial system, what has happened is that there is excess amount of savings or investment capital around the world, and it is created, and it has been created, through the issuance of tremendous amount of debt worldwide. So we're in a situation where there is way too much debt and way too much investment capital. The two things have inflated a lot of things, including the stock market, the real estate market, and so on. But at the end of the day, we have biophysical constraints due to the fact that we live on a finite planet with finite natural resources, and we are in a finite place, yet the financial capital and money can grow with no limits through an expansion of balance sheets. So what I've been trying to say is that we have way too much investment capital out there, and it's not worth what we think it's worth. So we are seeing just a little feel for the lack of reality in investment. You know, what is the stock market really worth? We don't know. In a day, it could be down another $2 trillion, right? So my argument is that we need to invest in things that are real, close to home, that we can see and touch and smell. Bakers and a farm and so on. So in other words, that is something that is more directly related to value that can be around even after volatility or shocks to the system. I know I haven't answered your question when the next market crashes and should you stay there, but anyone who claim that they know when the market crash will come and how big it's going to be or if it is time to buy or sell, I've been in the industry for 20 years, don't know what they're talking about.
So it's begging for a natural correction, though.
We've seen just, I think we're getting a sense for the fact that our investments are not as real as we thought, if they can drop in value so quickly. And a lot of it is the leverage in the financial system. You know, like, for example, the Chinese market went down 30%. Why? Because a lot of people are borrowing to invest in the stock market, which means that when the stock market goes down, then the margin calls start coming in, and people have to liquidate the portfolio to return their loans that allow them to buy the shares in the first place. We don't know how much of that is out there, how much of the values of the securities is driven by the fact that people have borrowed money to invest in those. And at what point, when the decline in the values of securities reaches critical point where it will basically go into this loop of liquidation to meet margin calls and that cause additional margin calls because now the value of the securities have dropped again. So, I mean, these are the challenges of having a global financial system where there is way too much money out there chasing, whether it's stocks, bonds, or real estate.
So it has to naturally correct.
Hmm?
It has to naturally correct.
My view is that, 50 years from now, we'll have less money overall than we have right now. I mean, we have about, $300 trillion worth of liquid financial capital. It might not be in line with what can be supported by the natural environment. But, whether it's going to happen 10 years from now, 20, I don't know. But environmental shocks will probably... There's a part of my talk on the 23rd that relates to that more directly.
Thank you.
Yep.
Hi. Within the realm of the things you can see, touch, and smell as good investments, can you visualize a scenario in which we use the coming boom in solar and wind, new electrical vehicles, conversions of old vehicles, and renewable energy storage building retrofits and all the rest of it for buildings, like in the new Apollo Alliance program, all of which are highly profitable for the user to pay enough money and to pay enough money in power to fund the other things we need to do. In other words, if we focused on this gold rush that's going to happen starting in about 2 years from now, as the batteries get cheap enough, and I know, and as the wind and the solar also come down, to where there is no way that the existing energy system can compete, we have an opportunity to use these things and leverage money into them. And can you envision a scenario in which we can actually really organize that process separately from the government, but in an organized, ethically driven way and driven by environment? Can you see how we could do that?
That is a very good question. And there are so many angles because, for one thing, we're in an oil glut right now. So the price of oil has declined by 50% in the last year. That has put a big dent on solar and other renewable technologies. This is the result of the fracking in the United States and bringing the shale oil into market, and how a lot of those operations are financed by debt, and so they cannot stop producing because they have the debt that forces them to continue, even though that creates a glut in the market. So
it also helps drive them out of business. The Saudis are actually deliberately trying to drive fracking out of business.
You know, whatever the dynamic is, I mean, there's that one issue, right, which is basically the price of oil affects the profitability of electricity, you know, generated in a different way in a sustainable manner. There is also the argument that the oil industry has been massively subsidized. You could even think that the majority of our military expenditures are to secure, access to oil reserves around the world
and
free transfers. So that's the other thing.
Right.
But so, and the other thing that I want to say is that the profitability of solar projects, for example, depends crucially on financing. So whether you're financing it with a 5-year loan or a 20-year loan, whether it's a 1% interest versus 3% interest, that determines whether your solar project is competitive with oil or not at this point. And so this is one more reason why we should have, for example, the Federal Reserve, fund the Reconstruction Finance Corporation that is mandated to invest in solar and provide very low interest loans for a very long period of time, and allow that sector of the economy to grow. In other words, financing is really the key of what happens in society. And if we want to see renewable resources and energy, we need to finance it in the proper way. And one way to do that is to use the Federal Reserve to keep interest rate low on those particular bonds, funding the right thing we want to see, as opposed to funding carry trades of financial institutions around the world.
Yeah, but my question is really, can you see a way in which those outside of the sphere who don't have those levers of control can use it to flip things? Because within 2 years, the cost will be lower than the cost of the facilities with zero cost for fuel. The cost of solar will be so low, and wind, and the cost of the battery storage to make it 24/7 available. So
I mean,
can you come up with a way in which, without controlling the Fed and without controlling the government, we can still organize, the whole movement can organize in such a way as to get the job done with the money that's floating around looking for a home and with the savings that consumers will have after they've paid off the systems. They'll have zero cost for energy.
You can at the margin. And that's, like trying to get people to move their own money from Wall Street to projects of this sort that tends to be, longer duration. No liquidity. You invest in a project that is going to pay off in 10 years. Your money's
locked
like in.
More like two to five.
Yeah. So in other words, but you can do that at the margin. But really, to do societal transformation of the size and speed that we need to have institutional support. We need to regain control of the institutions that are making this much easier. And you know, the Department of Energy is helping a little bit. In other words, there are leverage that we can use. But to answer your direct question, it can be done only at the margin. If you're saying, I don't care about what the government is doing and all its institutions and all the big muck, you know, we as people can organize with our own funds, you can do that, but the effect is going to be marginal, positive, but marginal.
Thank you.
Hello, I have a question about alternative currencies. And my belief is that alternative currencies are manifold. We can do it if we wish to. A gift card might be an alternative currency as well as a coupon or something of that nature. Do you have any opinion as to how viable that would be if scaled up to sort of displace or change the balance from debt currencies to a more gifted currency?
Some of the most successful alternative currencies are the WIR, right, in Switzerland, which is a peer-to-peer lending system, a business-to-business, the equivalent of the LETS here, the local economy, mm-hmm. you know, local electronic, trading systems. So there is something to be said that. In that case, now remember that the credit that can be created by each individual is not tied to interest, right? So there is no interest when you create a credit, but there is a limit as to how much you can create. So the scale issue is a tough one because that's what is so powerful about the banking sector. They can monetize liabilities that go out 30 years and are much, you know, think about how would you create with local currencies a credit system that mobilizes $10 trillion? I mean, that is the scale of the current money system, and that's why we should not forget about that. But there are a number of currencies that have been very successful. The best one, I think, is the C3 in Brazil, where businesses that are doing business with the government can monetize their account receivable and turn it into currency that facilitate economic transactions. So in other words, they're guaranteed by the fact that the government 3 months from now is going to actually pay, and that mobilizes a lot of economic activity. So in general, to go to scale, you need to have some sort of government entity that supports it.
Or perhaps some other trusted entity that could evaluate the worthiness or stability, or you know, sort of a
right.
a more moral form of
right.
I don't know, Standard & Poor's.
Right, and I have a bunch of books here on money and banking, and this one is, if you haven't read this one, you probably want to get this, which is Thomas Greco is an expert on alternative currencies. And what are the key design features that make a local currency viable? And a lot of time, what the local currencies that falter, they usually are started by young men in their 30s, very enthusiastic, and then 2 years from now, you check with them and it's all gone, mostly because they underestimate the amount of coordination and effort that it takes to make a local currency operate. The problem of accumulation into little pockets, like the preferred providers of services to the community get all this money that they cannot spend.
Right.
How do you recirculate that? You know, how do you fund the operations and maintenance of those currencies? So that would be a good, you know, if you haven't read, that's a good book to start with.
Well, thank you. I might want to check it that afterwards. Thanks.
Okay, so I wanted to ask about Bitcoin again. The when you talked with us a couple years ago, you talked about the way I remember it. The attribute of this money system is it creates itself and it expands exponentially. But it would be better if it would be a fixed size. So that's one of the attributes of Bitcoin, is it's a fixed size. And I've been noticing in the news that lots of big banks and VCs and all that kind of people are really interested in Bitcoin. They're studying the technology. It's like, okay, so it would have, today you didn't talk about a fixed size currency. So what do you think about that now?
Well, the idea of a fixed size currency is not ideal per se, because like when we had gold, right? Gold, you could think of gold as a fixed, almost fixed size ultimate currency. And you had booms and busts when you had the gold standard. Because one thing that you need to understand is that even when we had the gold standard, you have a construct of credit on top of it, right? So, I mean, there were banks creating money even during the gold standard. And when, for example, the Spaniards found all the gold from the United States and imported into Europe, it created massive inflation. Mm-hmm. So, in other words, what you want is the proper amount of money in circulation to have to accommodate the level of economic transaction without creating excessive inflation in the prices or deflation. So the Bitcoin, you know, first of all, it's just a software and they could change the maximum. I mean, they say 21 million, but there is no reason why at a certain point, once they get to 21 million and there is a lot of inflation in the price of Bitcoins, that they, especially if it goes into the hands of you know, some of the mucky mucks in Wall Street, they decide, oh, why don't we have 25 million? You know, it's like there is no, right? It's not like the gold that you cannot create it unless you have a supernova explosion. This you can create by changing some code line that says 21 million is no longer the limit. So,
And it's also that there's no magic about Bitcoin itself because you can create a parallel, you know, there's Litecoin and all these other whatever coins. You know, you could create another system that sits right beside it and has different rules.
Sure, absolutely. But what I'm saying is that I never said that you need a fixed quantity of currency and that would be the ideal situation. The ideal situation is to have the proper amount of currency in circulation to facilitate all the economic transactions that need to happen and they're positive for the economy without creating undue inflation or deflation. And so every time you have a constriction in the total amount of money, you can either get deflation, which is really problematic, or you can have excessive inflation when there is too much of that, you know, limited quantity arriving for some reason into a particular country. But in general, I would say it's a super clever idea. A lot of, you know, the Bitcoin is opening the possibility for non-state currencies being created, and there is a gold rush, obviously, in trying to come up with the next Bitcoin because some people want to get really, really rich. And depending on what is the motivation behind the design of the currency. In other words, are all these venture capitalists that are jumping on the bandwagon doing it because they really want to build something that is healthy for society and finances the right thing, or are they in to make a shitload of money? Pardon my French. So, and if that's the case, the design of the currency itself might not be ideal for the positive outcomes of society.
Yep.
Hi, thank you. I was really fascinated by your point that interest is not serving a great big purpose. It's not really increasing things, and once you said it, yeah, it made a lot of sense. On that, I remember a point in time when we had a mortgage that was 15 or 16%, but we could put our money in the bank and get 12%. There always seemed to be this fairly rigid difference between what the interest rates were and what you could earn on the interest, and those seemed to have widened spectacularly, and especially I think I can earn, you know, 0.5% on a savings account, yet the lowest, you know, credit card thing you can get is 13%. And the what is that doing to us? Is there any way around it? It's just extraordinarily frustrating, especially because the people that can least afford it. I mean, I understand the whole concept of risk to the bank, that it's higher risk, but at a certain point, I think they're risking being able to collect the money because they're charging so much in interest that they're basically bankrupting the poor people.
That is such a, I mean, to answer properly that question, I would need 2 hours. But let me first say that I'm not against interest per se, in the sense that if somebody has money and you're asking that person to give you some money, they need to be compensated for the fact that they are postponing their consumption for the next 2-3 years so that you can consume now, right? So in other words, it's not, I mean, interest is not per se, you know, unreasonable or illogic.
And I understand
you know, to a certain extent, you know, that's the first thing to say. Now, if all money is created as debt and you have no money created for the interest, that is a systemic issue. So you could have, in fact, maybe I should go back to the Pennsylvania case. Oops, I think I just jumped out of it. But I had an example of how the Pennsylvania colony issued the money in the right way. The government issued fiat currency. The first time they created 15,000 of them, they lent 11,000 at 5% interest, and the other four they spent into the economy to pay for the services that the government was providing. Now, that is a system that creates enough money to repay the interest, because the people had to return a little bit more than 11,000 to the government, but there was an additional 4,000, more than enough, to repay the interest. And so you could have a system that has some interest, but it's not self-destructive like the one we have. And the other one is the fact that we have very low interest rates right now is a transfer of wealth to the people that can speculate, and mostly is a transfer of wealth from retired people that are depending on their bond portfolio to survive. You know, older people obviously are not going to have a lot of risky investments in their portfolio. They have more safer, investments like bonds. And the bonds, the interest that come down so much, is effectively a transfer of wealth from, you know, the older population in the United States to the people that can speculate with that money and borrow it really cheap to go all over the world and buy who knows what. So that's, you know, the issue of where the interest rates are is also another policy lever that should not be simply controlled in the interest of financial speculation, but also of what we want to have as a society. I'm not sure I answered your question, but it's complex.
Yeah, okay. I'll come back to the next one.
Hi. Looking at sources of funding for what I was asking about earlier, what about mass, excuse me, mass divestment by pension funds and state and local treasuries, pulling them out of the fossil fuel and nuclear industries, and then, and also taking all the subsidies away, but that's later. But flexibly, pulling out the pension funds, and because of the divestment risks of what their investments are in,
right?
Especially with, we got to leave it in the ground,
right?
And we've got the whole political movement, 350 and all the rest.
Yep.
So what about, and then state and local treasuries putting their money, investing those floats into relatively shorter term project based investments, which are going to get paid back as those projects are completed. So what about that as a mechanism to bust loose trillions of dollars and actually get the transformation of the energy economy complete?
Right. We'll talk about more the last talk, which is really about finance, investments, and so on. And in general, you know, I don't have a solution. The solution has to be a collective one. In other words, we just need to know what are the mechanisms and what are the levers that we can move. And then collectively we can decide. I mean, it's like just because I'm here speaking, I'm not, you know, my opinion is not more important than any of you, because it is our collective decision-making that needs to be reflected in the institutions we build and what we finance, at what cost, you know, in what terms, and so on. I'm 100% in agreement with you that we need to stop, you know, leaving the oil in the ground so that the climate is not going to, you know, destroy our chances to survive on this planet, and we need to move our energy, you know, A, reduce the energy use, and B, you know, finance the things that can produce the energy without destroying the planet. You know, I'm totally in agreement with you. And in fact, you see, the money and finance issue, you know, system is key. We need to tackle that to do the type of changes that are required for us to be around another couple of generations.
Yeah, but perhaps a strategy that can be operated on a somewhat smaller scale can be the trim tab that turns the rudder on that.
Absolutely, and we, you know, the local sphere is, local government can be more responsive to the people because they're closer to the people, and so you can do, you know, there is a finance reconstruction corporation in California. It just has not been funded or expanded. You know,
Jerry Brown. We do have PACE and CCAs.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
Anyhow.
So, Marco, I had a question too. As you know, Debbie and I have moved our money out of the big banks and into the local bank, and I've started devoting a certain portion of my IRAs even to local investments through the slow money movement. And I'd like to increase the percentage of my IRAs that are doing that. I think in your third presentation, we get to that aha moment where you say, you know, which part of the suicide economy did you not understand?
Right.
But could you give us a foreshadowing for, you know, for example, if I tell my broker to put a larger percentage of my IRAs into a self-directed and local slow money investments with people I know and can see and touch, they're going to complain that any fluctuations in the system of as a whole is going to influence the capacity of the small organic farmer to repay my note. You know, and they're going to argue with me about that moment when I get on the phone and say, make the distribution, right? So I would like to know if you have a foreshadowing of, you know, how to answer that.
The whole financial system has been set up to make it really easy for us not to worry about our money. I mean, not to deal with our money, right? So there are mutual funds, there are experts that are doing this, you have financial advisors to give the money, say, okay, you deal with this. Because doing direct investing and, as you've done, trying to decide, shall I finance this crowd company or this bakery? What do I understand about their business model, the risks involved? I mean, it's really a hard thing to do. So in terms of your broker, he is a fiduciary. So he is legally required to protect your investments and to avoid excessive risks for you. So because of that, he will never say, oh yeah, you should invest in the local business here. He will say, no, it's too risky. And you know, he might be right at that level. The problem is that it's too risky to leave the money where it is, because we're overall creating this big systemic risk at the planetary level. And so this is the issue where you as individual owner of the funds can make that decision when your fiduciary will never be able to do it for you. You see what I mean? It's really a question of personal choice. Oh, wait. Two more there.
Oh, I didn't even see you guys, sorry.
So I just wanted to know if it's possible to get a copy of your foils. I've taken some pictures and taken some notes, but I missed some. So
yes, so have you signed my mailing list? Has been
yes,
around. Okay, so what I can do is I'll send you a note to all of you, and if you want the presentation, just email me back. I don't want to send it to everybody because it's a huge one,
yeah.
But I can send you the presentation if you're interested in it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, first of all, thank you. I really enjoyed it. It was extremely informative. My question is, you mentioned Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren. Elizabeth Warren, as we all know, was a legal scholar before entering the government. Are there any current legal scholars whose work you particularly admire? And is there any legal academic literature you would recommend?
I really like the work of Timothy Canova. He is a constitutional law professor and expert on the Federal Reserve. In Florida. And by the way, there is a really cool book that I would recommend, just came out recently. It's called When Government Helped, Learning from the Successes and Failures of the New Deal. And it's a series of articles. The third one is by Timothy Canova on what happened to the Federal Reserve, the Finance Reconstruction Corporation. You know, it's really interesting what the Roosevelt administration did with the banking sector and the finance sector in the United States, both good and bad. And you'll probably find that of interest because he is an academic and a law professor that also understands systems of the money system and Federal Reserve and so on. He did an article about recently about the public option in finance that you will find interesting. Is called The Public Option, The Case for Parallel Banking, Public Banking Institutions in the New American Foundation, June 2011.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi. How is debt-free money created?
Debt-free money is created the same way our coins are created. The coins are minted by the U.S. Treasury Mint and put in circulation. So the same thing is would be with the dollar notes or the electronic money. I mean, we've done it before. You just have the Treasury issue a certain amount of either electronic dollars or paper dollars, mm-hmm. And put it in circulation. So it's actually quite simple.
All right. Well, I guess I must have missed something basic in the presentation, because you said the Fed was creating money,
right?
Based on debt.
Oh, the Federal Reserve now. Historically, you could make an argument that the paper money created by the Fed was backed by U.S. Treasury bills and bonds. So you could make the argument that without a corresponding debt of the government, the Federal Reserve could not issue that money. That's because it's money based on accounting, where you have a liability and you have an asset, and they have to match. Mm-hmm. And so the assets of the Federal Reserve is the U.S. Treasuries, and against those, the Federal Reserve creates the money in circulation. So the money in circulation corresponds to debt of the government. But you could also have a situation where the U.S. Treasury simply issues the money without that being its liability, just being fiat money printed and put in circulation. Okay. It was done, the government authorized, Congress authorized $400 million worth of greenbacks during the Civil War, and not exactly $400 million were issued, but they were basically just printed by the U.S. Treasury, and with that they paid for war goods and they paid the troops, and the troops spent them, and then they were accepted in payment of taxes. Mm-hmm. But they were not backed by gold. So people could not go to a bank and say, I want my gold now.
Okay, so it's sort of like a local currency, but on a grand scale.
Yeah.
Because it's between people who both agree that it will have value.
Yeah. But right now, this thing, if you go to the Federal Reserve, you get another one of this.
Right.
Okay. Right? That's
it. It's not a silver certificate.
Exactly. There is not a certificate. You can't get gold out of this. You just, it's a paper thing. You can give them the old paper, they give you a new paper. That's it.
Right.
Now, why not the Treasury doing that and doing that without issuing bonds? Somebody said if the government is good for a Treasury bond, it should be good
right.
for a paper bill.
Okay, thank you. I think I understand it better now.
That's a great question. Thank you. Marco, I want to take a moment and...
On cue at 2 exactly. You guys made it through 2 hours of... money and banking.
I want to thank you for this extraordinary, not only presentation, but community conversation that we all need to be having right now. Thank you, Marco.
Thank you.